What? Hello and welcome to the Lharbur Show. My name is Luke Harbur. I am your host, and today we have the incredible Caden Laptad. Caden, how we doing?
Luke, I'm doing great. Thanks for having me out here.
You are super duper welcome. Are you ready to do this?
I think so. It's my first time doing anything like this, so we'll see.
Sweet. Sounds good, man. Okay, so first we've got Harbur Hot Takes. Mr. Caden here is going to get three topics, and he only gets one sentence to give his answer to each topic. So, Mr. Caden, are you ready to do your three Harbur hot takes?
Let's do it.
Amazing. Number one, what is your least favorite thing about being a teacher?
I think my least favorite thing, and here's my sentence, is my least favorite thing is being expected to take on 10 different roles in a normal 40-hour work week justified by summer vacation.
Fair enough. And that was a very well-articulated sentence. Number two, what made you want to teach?
Teaching was something that I discovered that allowed me to continue my love of math, and also to fulfill my mission statement for my life, which is helping others better understand who they are, whose they are, and where they're going.
Wow. There were so many commas and semicolons, and I love that. No, that was amazing.
That's my cheating way of getting one sentence with lots of
No, words. That's good. And we've had lots of guests do that, and it's very smart. Last but not least, Caden, hot take number three. What are your thoughts on hygiene?
If your mama wouldn't kiss it, it's probably not clean.
Oh! Oh! And now we've moved on to our second segment of the show, which is Harbur Talk. Caden here has three topics that we are going to explore in depth for 9 minutes total. And we can talk about these topics a little more or a little less, just depending on how long we want to talk about each topic within the 9 minute period. Does that sound
Sounds
good?
Good, man. Absolutely. Let's do it.
Amazing. Let's do it. Starting the timer in 3, 2, 1. So Caden, I know even in Harbur Hot Takes, we talked a lot about teaching related things. It was two of the three topics, but I've got to ask you this taboo topic in particular. How do you deal with difficult students?
Luke, that's a really good question. And honestly, with this being my third year teaching, I feel like I'm learning new things. Every year I discover a new answer to that question. I think the big things that I've started to realize is just the importance of understanding what a student's home life has been like. How they've related to authority figures in the past, and really how can I be a different counter narrative to those students? How can I give them a different experience that undermines their expectations and forces them to see me as a human and someone that's trying to help them, which is difficult.
So give me an example or an anecdote of when you were seen as authoritative and then you saw or felt that switch. Give me an example.
Great question. Actually, something just happened this past week. I had a student who sent me an email that was very direct, we'll say. And it was a situation in which I could tell the student was very frustrated, and they didn't feel like they'd really been heard. And so one of the things that happened is I asked that student to stay after class so we could talk, and I locked the door so no one else could, you know, invade. That way there was privacy. Okay. And I was pretty frustrated, to say the least. And so one of the things I did is I tried to step back because I could see that the student was willing, but also I could see there was some angst. And so I had this sense that maybe in the past, authority figures had kind of crushed or quashed the student's ability to kind of share their voice. And so I said, well, hey, will you, student, kind of tell me what this was all about? And in listening to that, one of the things that I was able to do was to take a position. I actually sat in a desk, so I was lower in physical stature than the student. So that way they were looking down at me. And I think that sense of humility, as they shared and started talking about things, they weren't quite as angry at me. And so it gave us the space to kind of open up. And it gave me the opportunity to really push in and go, hey, I want to be with you. I want to support you. I'm on your side. You know, and if I'm going to respect you, right, you've got to show some of that back to me. And so it was a really, really challenging conversation, but one that really turned the tides. So,
wow. Thank you for sharing that. And it's wonderful and so important to see that in a teacher, because a teacher is the one that can guide you to such an amazing place when you make that connection. So thank you for doing a public service.
I'm doing my best.
That's amazing.
I love it. It's an honor.
That's the way it should be. We want more of that attitude. Number two, as our taboo topic that we want to tackle today, is the concept of being smart. So especially in school, I know that there's sort of this clique, or I guess archetype, of being nerdy or smart, but I want you to tell me, why do you think that's a taboo topic for somebody to talk about?
Well, here's the thing. I think the reality is students who are seen as smart are kind of actually put into their own camp and kind of put into their own pigeonholes that sometimes aren't fully seen. One of the things that I noticed growing up is that there are many times where if you're a student that others identify as having a gift of intelligence, they'll sometimes look to you to be the source of knowledge or information in a way that is really kind of actually isolating to relationship. And what's really surprising is I remember having friends growing up that would say, oh, Caden has these answers. He knows all these things, right? And there was this sense of putting me in a different group of being just for my intelligence. And what happened was it made it really hard for me to build friendships with some of those friends, because they go, well, you know, he's just the really smart kid. And that's what was, that kind of ended the statement. It wasn't, and he really is passionate about this thing too, or he could really learn right. something from me. And I think that's the challenge, is people who are seen as smart are seen as not necessarily, I think others don't realize that they can teach those students and persons so many more things than they realize. And so it can feel isolating to be like, oh, they're smart. They must have figured this out.
Yeah. And it in listening to you, it sounds like maybe there are even moments of in school where you'd be like, God, don't you just want to like hang out with me? Or God, don't you just want to like talk to me as a normal person? Why are you putting me on this like intellectual pedestal?
Absolutely.
Would you say that's right? Is that kind
Absolutely.
Of the right way of
and I think it's you know, it doesn't go to the human part, which is I'm still making mistakes, right? I'm still stressed. I'm still anxious. I still know what I'm doing, right? Just because I can be more creative or articulate doesn't mean that I can change the chaos of life, right? So I think it just is one of those things where I think while it is a gift to have a mind that is really thoughtful and pursues knowledge and information, I think realizing that those are people too is really important to understand that they just want to be accepted and loved just like everybody else.
Beautifully said. We all deserve love and kindness. That is my philosophy. And last but not least for Harbur Talk, I would love to ask you personally about religion. So for you in your life, why has this been a taboo topic?
Well, Luke, little bit of a taboo topic for me, primarily because I grew up with a very, very literal understanding of my spiritual faith. So I grew up in a Christian evangelical upbringing. And I was one of the people, probably because of the way my mind worked, who took it very, very seriously. Right. To the point where I was very judgmental. And in a lot of ways, I was so focused on following these particular codes and laws and these do's and don'ts, right? All these right. conditionals. Uh-huh. I found that it consumed me so much that there was a time in my life when I made it to college and when I still continued and was involved in a lot of religious organizations where I remember having a conversation with someone about spirituality and their expression of it. And I remember feeling this sense of, when are they going to be done with what they're saying so that I can give my spiel, right? And that was a moment for me where I realized that something was missing, right? If my whole idea of this is what brings people life and joy and hope, and that hope is at the detriment of their personhood and their experience, that for me is where I realized that maybe religion was getting in the way of being spiritual.
Wow. So for you now, today, what does religion mean to you?
I think I look at them a little bit differently as two pieces. For me, religion is the ways that we try to create conditionals. If I do this, then this happens, in order to pursue virtue. It's the structure that we build to pursue the virtues, and we do it as a community. And so for me, religion is experienced most in a small community, wherever you gather with friends or family or people in a congregation. But for me, spirituality is the goal, and the goal is the unconditional pursuit of virtue. Spirituality calls, religion codifies. So to me, when someone says, well, what is justice? Show them a video of someone being unjustly beat, and there's no need to define it. It calls. And so to me, that's what spirituality is at its heart. What is love? Well, love calls. Love is not defined by a condition of if I do this, then this is love. Right. Love is beyond and transcendent above that. And all of our conditionals are our ways of adapting to try to continue pursuing that virtue with everything that we have.
Wow. And virtue is, again, something I think people are trying to find through their own culture, their own set of means, their own set of values. But that is where religion can be such a beautiful thing.
Absolutely.
When it's authentically being expressed and is not being used as a tool to necessarily draw someone in. It's a tool to enhance someone's perspective and to enhance their life and to be giving.
Absolutely.
And kind.
And to me, the ultimate lie is the belief that we are all individuals or we are all a collective one. Mm-hmm. We need to find our experiences and the tension between the two.
Right.
So.
Wow. And with that, Mr. Caden, you just did some Harbur talk.
Absolutely.
Congratulations, my friend.
Thank you, sir.
Caden, thank you so freaking much for coming on to the show today.
Absolutely, Luke. Thanks for having me.
You're welcome. Are you ready for the end slate?
Oh, let's do it.
Amazing. So here we go.
Pause, play, try to be kind,
and keep making a difference. We'll see you guys soon.
Awesome. Have a great one.
Whoa! Did this cat? No!
I think it's okay. But it's fine. We're great. Right,
left, right.